So, quickly going to pull out some of the elements of this story. All Quiet on the Western Front, a remake or another version, remade in 22, and nominated for Best Film in the 2023 Oscars, which I'm happy about because it's a great movie, and foreign language films should be nominated for the Oscars if the Oscars wants to. Well, we all know that the Oscars exist to sell movies, but if the Oscars wants to be known as the premier event in terms of the best films worldwide, then they're going to have to start including foreign language films. So, as with the usual pattern, we're going to go over basic story architecture, and then I'll just show you how this follows the process. And it does, and there are lots of well, you'll see in a second. Let's go over basic story architecture first. So when you first start writing and filmmaking, you have a linear perspective in that sense. Pretty soon you realize that both the beginning and the ending are the same, which is why we demonstrate story structure via a loop. We identify the classic beginning and ending as a state of perfection, which is lost becomes a state of imperfection, the loss phase, the limitations phase, and the process of returning to it is undergone. State of perfection can also be described as paradised, which is lost. So paradised lost, and that phraseology seems to be more acceptable to some people. And with paradise lost, you have the symbols of paradise and the symbols of paradise lost. So, for example, you have fertility, and then fertility will be lost. You're going to have family, and your family will be lost. So, for example, the orphan scenario there, you're whole here, you're damaged there. You have faith here, you lose your faith there. Belief is another way of putting it. And so on and so forth. So, if you don't like the state of perfection terminology, you can look at it from the point of view of paradise or paradise lost. And that takes us back to Genesis and the religious texts. So, you can start there or somewhere in between. If you do that, the events there tend to be referenced in later stages, as in this story. Most stories end with some form of state of perfection. If you don't want to do that, if you want to end with imperfection or some combination, that's almost irrelevant. The process is always the same. So you're always going to have transformation, change, metamorphosis, transmogrification, the various arcs, all the symbols and signals of transformation. You're always going to have physical journey, and you're always moving through new worlds, which are physical manifestations of new psychological states and new versions of the self. So working your way around the cycle involves jumping through lots of hoops, and each hoop has its own set of sub-stages, which in essence are functions which may be performed, messages which may be communicated that show you what tangibles are. In tangibles, you're going in there to acquire how to construct those sequences and so on. So, for example, if that's the ordinary world, we know it's a state of protection, repression, fear of exit, etc. And that those sub-stages show you how to construct those sequences. When you're here, you're not able to return. You have to go forward, grow, learn, mature, arc all the way around until you're ready to return. So that's basic story architecture. It's the fundamental framework that all successful stories are based around. And I go over that in great detail in the 2100 stage of journey transformation, movement through new worlds and states, which you can purchase off the website. So now let's get rid of that and let's draw another loop. And we know now there's much more behind that a loop than a simple circle would suggest. So, All Quiet on the Western Front 2022. I'm going to start with something that one of the characters, Kat, said when Paul and his friends meet him in the trenches. And I'm going to put that just before the first threshold, because Kat is kind of a mentor, kind of a supernatural aid. And his one of his statements is that man is a beast. And that is one of the underlining ideas behind this movie. It's one of the ideas that underpins it. And I'm going to go with that for the purposes of this demonstration. And then it'll show you how everything becomes slightly more meaningful. So we kick off. Paradise has already been lost. We're in a war zone. Our first scene is of beasts huddling together and trying to keep warm I suppose near the trenches. And we're basically in the world of the beast, and we have all these innocent men and they're being slaughtered on the trenches, literally the world of the beast. And and then we have the whole recycling uniform thing, which in essence is some kind of metaphor for the recycling of men, of human beings, being put through this bestial world. And then we go into our old new world, and we meet our main characters, and they're young men, they're innocent, they're naive, and we have this whole process of going from innocence to maturity, some sort of maturation arc, from naivety to awakening, which is one of the other aspects of returning to the state of fiction of Paradise Lost. And importantly, as an opposite to the world of the beast, they are civilized. And again, as I said earlier, in this ordinary world, they're protected. And there is a lot of encouragement to stay in this state. So Paul's father says, don't go. He's acting as an interdictor, very much like Uncle Owen in Star Wars, in A New Hope. Don't go. And his father is saying, for good reason this time, don't go. But Paul is keen to go, and so forges his father's signature. And if I remember rightly, he's not even 18, and that's why he has to do that. So they're in this ordinary state, represented by all various types of signals and symbols. So then they're off on their journey, willingly, almost foolishly, and you have the, in essence, the edge of the ordinary world, and you've got the, before you come to the first threshold, and in essence, you're sending out warnings and signals that this argument, right, that all of this represents, is actually false or inaccurate at best. And so you've got them, and their commanding officers are not as nice as everybody was in school. In their normal, ordinary world, you've got the doctor pulling the lorries aside, saying, look, we need these lorries to transport all these injured men. And they end up in this horrific courtyard scenario where there are lots of injured men. And they're going to end up there again in the world of the atonement. So we're going to start at one place. We arrive, we don't belong in essence, and by the time we come back around, we will belong and be very familiar with this. And then we meet our supernatural aide, Kat, who says, look, again, you know, man is a beast, your underlying idea, and he's giving them tips on how to survive. You know, put your freezing hands in your inside your pants, and again, this is not what they expected it to be. They've got to shovel water out of the trenches. And then we enter the first threshold, and I'm going to mark that at the point where Paul sticks his head up over the trench and he's actually shot at and is surprised that that's going to happen. And then we go into our whole first threshold scenario where we're beginning the process of, you know, reversing this, all of these ideas. So not only do we not belong, we're very innocent, we're going to begin our awakening, etc. and so forth. And so we go into our inner cave, we start to be bombarded with missiles, we have to hide in the bunker. The bunker itself falls, collapses. We want to return, but we're not able to. It's one of the functions of the journey. There's no possibility of returning, and some of our Fellow soldiers want to return, but there's nowhere back. They're held back by Captain and also they're just, shot to pieces when they try to do it. And then, the bunker collapses and you wake up and so that's our first threshold separation. One of the things that happens there is the beginning of the awakening. So literally, Paul wakes up and he goes, "Holy shit!" And then we go into our belly of the whale sequences, where you realize the nature of things, and you've got that separated out. So you've got Paul finding one of his schoolmates dead, and then we go into this scene where we meet the bureaucrats, and they realize that there are, I think 40,000 men have died in the last 24 hours, or a horrific figure in a very short time. And then we meet our two character or characters that are representative of the opposing world. So you've got the bureaucrat, I forget his name, the character's name, and he is in essence civilized. So he comes from this world that the boys originally come from, and he has to confront the characters that represent the beasts. And he calls them the gentlemen, so they're dressed as though they're from civilized, as though they're civilized, but really underneath they're beasts. And their incentive is to keep the war going, to maintain this world of the beast. We have our physical separation, and we have our setup for a. Our third act, and this is where we've got Cat and Paul stealing the goose, and they're going to, in essence, confront the child, get glimpses of the child in this section, who represents man as a beast. So this is when the child actually shoots Cat, and we see in his eyes that it's not necessarily a state of war. We're in essence proving our theorem that man is a beast. When that child is confronted, or when that child confronts and kills, shoots a cat. And then we have our bureaucrat, and you're going on this train journey trying to end it, and then you've got the opposing forces that are prolonging it. So it's the bureaucrat arguing for civilization as opposed to the beasts who are arguing to prolong it. And then we have our containment scenes. And this is where Paul and Kat are have to stay put in their field, and this is where they come to the conclusion, or they debate the two worlds, this world of war and the beast, and their civilized world, and then they realize that this is the argument that they want to choose. And so then we have the beginning of the return to that, the desire to return to that. So that's one of the rewards you get when you come out of the road of trials. Then you're moving forward, and we're sent back into the trenches, back into the deepening world, back into the world of the beast, and we show how we've transformed. So seeing the tangible sword is actually claiming the French trenches, but then what we do there is we demonstrate just how much we've changed, and we've become in essence beasts. So we have from not belonging to becoming representations of the characters that live in this world. And then we go, then the tanks arrive, and those send us into the world of the near-death experience, where we have our rebirth. So Paul is forced to kill a man in order to survive, and then he tries to wipe that man clean. And again, we've got this opposition where you've got the world of civilization, which is clean. The boys here are clean, and then as soon as we enter the trenches, very quickly they're covered in mud, and it's just dirt, dirt, dirt all the way. So he's trying to clean that man's face, and he's trying, and he promises to return the belongings to that man's wife, etc. So you've got all the elements of rebirth, and then we're put into the atonement, World of the Atonement, and that's where when Chad dies because he doesn't want to return. At this point, we've got the armistice has been signed, but again, the these civilized people, but who are beasts by nature, they won't halt any aggression until the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, and so on. And so we have our going into the third act. And then we have this atonement, really, where Paul says, I'm afraid to go back. And you are. You're afraid at this stage, as you've gone through all of this change, to go back. And then we've got Cats, hungry, goes back into to steal another goose for food, and we confront the child, which represents the beast. And Cat, being a mentor, what happens is you arrive at this stage, roughly this stage, and then you exit at this stage, and that's in essence what's happening to him. But he's confronting a representation of the beast in that child, and then we confront actually the beast itself, which is the general. And so meeting the general is an arc there all the way around, and it's the general who wants to prolong the war. He loves it, and he wants to keep sending his men into battle, and he doesn't agree with the bureaucrats who are about to end it, and he sends them in. And then that's when we have Cat, Paul, who has become the beast, being slaughtered in the final conflict. And then that brings us kind of round. So there you go. So, I mean, that's me just pulling out some of the elements of that story. You can see how, even though it doesn't look like a classical journey in the way that Avatar does, it follows the stages of the journey. It follows the stages of change. And it follows, it's paced in a certain way. And underpinning it is our ideas, which drive the journey and drive the change and give rise, or you know, are the roots of the characters that we are we are shown. Anyway, if you want a detailed deconstruction of that story, you can order it off the website. But once again, this whole process is gone over in great detail in the 2100 Stage Heroes Journey Transformation Movement Through New World and States, which you can purchase on the website. And also give one-to-one coaching sessions. I don't do that. I don't take on too many clients every year. But if you want a one-to-one coaching session, then I can give you the details and the nature of how I'll go about doing that if you contact me via the website. So yeah, that's a basic breakdown of that. An Academy Award nominee, best film for the Oscars 2023. And yeah, please go to the website.